Good morning, friends. I again welcome you all for the second lecture of semester 3. Friends, yesterday only in my previous lecture, I have discussed about the general syllabus of all the four papers that you have to study in this semester. And today, we want to begin with the discussion of paper number 7. As you know now, that as far as paper number 7 is concerned, one text which is assigned to you, which is prescribed to you by the university, is written by W. H. Hudson. Friends, the full name of this critic is William Henry Hudson. And this critic of English literature, W. H. Hudson, has written a very interesting and much informative book on literature, and the title of that book is An Introduction to the Study of Literature. Study of Literature. So friends, this is the title of the book written by William Henry Hudson. I repeat it again, the title is An Introduction to the Study of Literature. Friends, we are all the students of literature, and we have been studying this literature for last more than 1 year. When you took admission in this college with English as your special subject in semester 1, you started studying some lyrics, some poems. In first and second semesters, you studied some novels, some short stories, some plays. So in short, we have studied literature for more than 1 year, and we are the students of literature. But in this semester, we are going to study this in a theoretical manner. In this particular paper, paper number 7, and in this particular text, An Introduction to the Study of Literature, we are going to make our own concepts clear about what actually literature is. About what are the essential elements which makes literature a literature in the truest sense of the word. We are also going to study what are some of the important characteristics of literature which makes it literature. We are going to study some of the classifications of literature, some of the types of literature, some of the important forms of literature, chronological study of literature, historical study of literature, biographical study of literature, and so on. But right now, we want to begin with one question, and that is a very important question: what is literature? This is a question, you know, which is in a way easy to answer, but in a way very difficult to answer. क्योंकि हम सभी लोग को पता है कि साहित्य क्या है, लेकिन जब बोला जाए कि इनकी डेफिनेशन क्या है, देन इट इज डिफिकल्ट टू डिफाइन. सो टू गिव यू द रेफरेंस ऑफ द बुक, written by William Henry Hudson. Then Hudson says that everything which is written is called literature. Hudson has given reference to one critic whose name is De Quincey. De Quincey is an important thinker and a critic of English literature. De Quincey has defined literature as everything written is called literature. This is a very small, simple, easy to understand definition given by De Quincey. The reference of this is found in William Henry Hudson's book, An Introduction to the Study of Literature. When you were studying in semester 1, if you remember in my initial lectures, I had discussed about what literature is. And we understood that literature is the reflection of life. Literature is something which stands as a mirror to the society. That means what we understand today is that true literature is a mirror to this life and society. What we see in our life, what we experience in our life, is presented by the author, by the poet, by the novelist, by the dramatist in literature. Our own aspirations, our ambitions, our dreams, our problems, our solutions, our thoughts, our ideas, our observations, our experiences, all these things are beautifully, artistically reflected in literature by the authors. So in short, what we understood is that literature is the reflection of life and society. The author who is living in this society, he observes the society, he observes the lives of the people, and he tries to reflect the same things in his own poetry, in his own novel or a drama or a short story. But still, the idea is not clear. If you ask a question, what literature is, to this critic De Quincey, then he answers that everything written or everything printed is called literature. But now there is a problem. But now there is a question. The question is, if we go with this definition that everything written or printed is called literature, then the problem is that there are so many things printed or written in this world. Do we call them all literature? Say, for example, newspaper. A newspaper is printed, it is written. Should we call it literature? Say, for example, a timetable. Timetable is also printed, it is written. Do we call it literature? A medical report, when you go to a doctor, he writes some prescriptions, it is written. Do we call it literature? Or when you go to a laboratory, the laboratory technician gives you the whole medical report about your health. Do we call that medical report literature? A calendar, a dictionary, all these things are printed. All these things are written. Do we call it literature? Do we call them literature? This is a question. Because De Quincey has given this definition, everything written or printed is called literature. Now, to solve this issue, to solve this problem, let me mix up various things together to make it clear. I have just now given you a list of things, like you say calendar, a dictionary, your medical report, your prescriptions written by the doctor, your newspapers, your magazines. All these things are printed, but at the same time, your Bhagavad Gita is written, it is printed. Your Quran, your Bible, they are written, they are printed. Romeo and Juliet, a play written by William Shakespeare, printed. Old Man and the Sea, a novel written by Ernest Hemingway, an American novelist, it is printed. Pygmalion, a play, a comic play written by George Bernard Shaw, an American writer, American dramatist, it is written, it is printed. So all these things, the plays, the novels, the short stories, the epics, the lyrics, and at the same time, calendar, timetable, newspapers, magazines, medical reports, doctor's prescriptions, all these things are printed. So we are the students of literature. As a student of literature, are we supposed to study the timetables? Are we supposed to study the dictionaries? Are we supposed to study the newspapers and magazines? The answer is no. As a student of literature, it is not our job to study the newspapers and magazines and timetables and dictionaries. As a student of literature, we are only concerned with that literature which we understand and which W.H. Hudson makes it clear as literature. So the question is, how do we divide? How do we divide or how do we classify literature? Which literature is to be studied by the student? And which literature is not to be studied by the students of literature. To classify this, De Quincey and W.H. Hudson, do we have red pen? No, red pen is not available, but no problem, we will go with the blue one. Okay. Now, literature, according to De Quincey, can be classified into two broad categories. According to De Quincey, according to De Quincey and W.H. Hudson, literature can be classified into two broad categories. And these two broad categories are literature of knowledge and literature of power. So now try to understand, focus here and see that literature, what is literature? The definition, the common definition given by De Quincey is that everything which is written or printed is called literature. But that includes so many things, newspapers, magazines, poems, short stories, novels, timetables, everything. So how do we understand which literature is meant for the students of literature? To understand that, you need to understand the classification of literature given by W.H. Hudson and De Quincey. And this classification is that literature, there are two types of literature, one, the literature of knowledge, and two, literature of how. Now the question is, what is this literature of knowledge? According to De Quincey, the literature which just gives you some information or some knowledge about any particular field or area is called literature of knowledge. I repeat it again. He says that the literature which just gives you some primary information or primary knowledge about any particular area is called literature of knowledge. Say, for example, timetable. A timetable is printed, it is written, so we call it literature, fine. But it is literature of knowledge. Why? Because in timetable, we get some knowledge, we get some information about the timings of the lectures, about the timings of the college, about the timings of your recess. So it gives us a timetable, it gives us knowledge or information about the lectures. So you can say your timetable is literature of knowledge. Let's take another example. Say, for example, a dictionary. What is dictionary? Dictionary is printed. It is written, so we call it literature. But dictionary is also literature of knowledge. Why? Because the dictionary gives us the meanings of the words. The dictionary gives us the etymology of the words. That's all. It does nothing more than that. That means what? Dictionary provides us with some knowledge. It provides us with some information about the words and their meanings. So that's why your dictionary is literature of knowledge. In the same way, let's take another example, your medical reports. What is this medical report? It is printed, it is written, that's why we call it literature. But then this is also literature of knowledge. Why? Because this medical report gives you some information about your hemoglobin, about your heartbeats, about your other health issues. So you get some knowledge out of these medical reports. So medical reports are also known as literature of knowledge. And we are the students of literature. That doesn't mean that we need to study all these things. Why? Because these all types of literature, like timetable, dictionary, medical reports, say for example a newspaper or a magazine. What about a newspaper? A newspaper is literature of knowledge. Why? Because it gives us some information about sports, about political affairs, about the current affairs and all. It just gives us some knowledge. So that's why your newspaper, your magazine is also literature of knowledge. And as a student of literature, we are not supposed to study all these things. Now the question is, then what to study? As a student of literature, what do we have to study? The answer is that the student of literature studies the literature of power. The student of literature studies the literature of power. Now, what is this literature of power? According to De Quincey and W. H. Hudson, the literature which gives some power, some energy, some fuel to live our life in a better manner. And that literature is called literature of knowledge. The job of true literature, the job of true literature of power is to give some energy to the human beings to live their life in a better manner, in a better way. It makes the true literature makes our life a better life. And that is the true literature which we have to study as the students of literature have to study. Literature of power. In Sanskrit, it is said, Sa vidya ya vimuktaye. Sa vidya ya vimuktaye. That means what? This is the knowledge which makes you free. This is the knowledge which makes you free. Now the question is, free from what? According to me, literature has the power to make us free from ignorance. When I was a student in school, we used to sing one prayer, Unda Andareti Prabhu Param Teje Tu Laija. You must also have heard this prayer. Right? Literature has the capacity to make us free from ignorance. Literature makes us enlightened. It has this power. And true literature is for all times. And true literature is for all people. And true literature is for all geographical areas. And true literature is for all cultures. You just think about this. That Bhagavad Gita was written some way back before, some 5,000 years ago. And this Bhagavad Gita was meaningful in those times. It is meaningful in today's times. It will be meaningful. It will remain meaningful in the times to come. That is permanent literature. And that permanent literature is literature of power. Old Man in the Sea, a novel, a small novel written by an American novelist, Ernest Hemingway, was written in America, but it appeals to me in India also. It appeals to a person in Japan. It appeals to a person in UK. It appeals to a person in Australia. That means true literature is not meant for one country. It has no geographical barriers. It has no barriers of cultures. It is meant for all cultures, all countries, all times, all ages. That is true literature, and that literature is known as literature of power. It has energy. It provides us energy or fuel to live our life. It makes us human. It makes a man a human being. You know, there is a difference between these two words. We are all men. Of course, you are women. I'm not talking about that. But my point is, we are all man, but there is a difference between the word man and a human being. A human being is one who has the element of humanity in him or her. So where does this element of humanity come from? The element of humanity comes from literature. When we read such true literature, literature of power, when we read some good literature, the element of humanity enters into us. And we start becoming better human beings. And that makes a better society, and that makes a better nation. So, my friends, literature has a very important responsibility as far as the safety, as far as the moral safety of the nation is concerned. This is enough for today. Rest of the things we will discuss in the next lecture. I hope the ideas are clear to you so far. But if you have any doubts or questions or queries, you feel free to contact me on my WhatsApp number. Thank you.